But let's take a leap from leaves and let's start talking about spinal implants with Article 3. We're going to be looking at non-invasive spinal implants, and here's why. Dan, did you know that 1 in 12 Americans suffer from intractable back pain?
What is intractable back pain? My back hurts sometimes. I don't know what that means.
I'm glad you asked, Dan, because I didn't know what intractable back pain was until I Googled it. It's basically a pain that there's nothing you can do about it. You can't really treat it. You can't go after the cause of it. You can just kind of address the symptoms. Like imagine like some really, really bad pain that you have. It's not going to go away. The best you can do is live with the pain and just make it a little bit easier for you.
Okay. So like, that seems very, very significant. The fact that 1 in 12 Americans suffer from this pain. I imagine it will only get worse as more people shift to desk jobs and they're sitting all day.
Oh yeah.
So how do you treat this intractable back pain? I imagine that will lead us towards this article.
Exactly. So this is coming out of the University of Cambridge. I think the reason this research was even sparked is because the UK economy is actually spending about £12 billion every year on this. And they were talking about, you know, how it's not just impacting them, it's also impacting Americans. So it must be impacting majority of the developed world as well. And they looked into options into treating this, right? And what it came down to is that spinal stimulation treatments seem to be the main method of treatment. But given how many...
What is that? Do they just put some type of electrodes in you and give some electrical pulses to help ease the pain around the back? Is that what they're doing?
That's exactly right. They put electrical pads on your spinal cord and do electrical signals to stimulate and ease the pain.
Okay.
But what's interesting about it is given how many cases there are of people that have these issues, there's only about 50,000 procedures per year. So they wanted to understand like why is that the case? And what it boils down to is that there's really two options you have with spinal stimulation. You have one that's very invasive, which involves you going under general anesthesia and then having surgeons cut open your back and put this very long paddle-like electrode down and then being able to stimulate it. And then there's the non-invasive alternative, which covers a smaller portion of your spinal cord, but it doesn't require anesthesia and extensive surgery. So it's really not as effective. Given that knowledge, these researchers wanted to bring together the best of both worlds. Non-invasive and covers a lot of area to maximize the effectiveness, right? Totally makes sense. And the way they did this is by taking a page out of different engineering principles. So they're incorporating flexible electronics. We've talked about this before on the show, like we have flexible sensors and things like that for body monitoring. So it can bend. They're bringing in soft materials from soft robotics. That's where you can stimulate a material. Again, it can unroll, deform, change shape without really giving up any of its material properties. And they're incorporating microfluidic channels, little channels that you can pass fluids like oxygen or a liquid like water through it to expand the shape itself. And the way I like to think about this is, you know, those airplane safety guides, they have the inflatable ramps that eventually turn into boats. Yeah, yeah. Imagine you putting the fluid in and then it unrolls. And they're using that exact same principle for this device that is only 60 microns thick. Like think about as thin as a single fiber of your hair. That's how thin it is. They roll it up, they put it in a needle, and they inject it in your epidural region. And once it's in, the surgeons can inflate it so that it can actually start covering your entire spinal region and unroll into the paddle shape that they really want.
So they, let me see if I've got this right.
Okay.
They're using, you know, borrowing from different types of engineering. The flexible electronics is that the electrode that they're using itself is flexible and they can roll it up and unroll it without it being damaged.
You're right.
You know, the microfluidic channels is what you're talking about, how they can inflate it and it unrolls itself.
Mm-hmm.
So basically they've got this tiny thing that fits inside a needle. They inject it into a certain part of your spine and they can inflate it and it turns into the electrode that they would have had to cut you open to install. But instead they only had to poke a needle hole in your back instead of cutting you open.
You're exactly right. And what's wonderful about this is that it's actually so small and so thin that the surgeons, the way they detect that the device is fully implemented is through an X-ray. And the X-ray wasn't able to show the device because of how thin and small it is. So they actually had, they had to add bismuth elements to make it stand out. But they've tested this out on cadavers, and they know it works. In the next 2 to 3 years, they want to do human trials. And the lead researcher mentioned that due to the architecture, the way they've gone about designing this system, you can actually make changes to it to do different things, like spinal simulation for people that have spinal injuries, or they even mentioned something about Parkinson's treatments. So again, this is like one of those topics where it's like, this is the first step in a much bigger picture that we'll learn more about in the years to come. But kudos to the team, because this device is, again, non-invasive, it's scalable, it can be mass manufactured, and so far they've been able to demonstrate that it actually does work. So in the next 2 to 3 years, those 1 in 12 Americans that are suffering from really, really severe pain might have a feasible option of being able to live with it a little bit easier.
Yeah, that's really exciting to me. And I think technology development goes in the cycles where first we prove the concept. So, mm-hmm. you know, spinal cord stimulation works and it helps, but it's not that pretty, right? It requires, you know, putting someone under general anesthetics, you have to cut them open. It's pretty invasive. It's harmful. It's hurtful. You know, it's not that appealing to you as a patient, but we're starting to get to this point where the technology develops further and they start to care more about the patient experience and making sure that it's leaves them healthy and happy. And this is a really exciting application of new technology to me, because, you know, instead of treating only 50,000, which is just a fraction of those millions of Americans every year that are experiencing this back pain, it will hopefully be accessible to many more of them, because it's not a scary procedure anymore.
Agreed.